Justice Robert Jackson famously said that the Supreme Court is not final because it's infallible. It's infallible only because it's final. And I trust that would not be the case if the American people saw the Supreme Court as just another political branch. In simple terms, it means that the Supreme Court is the last word in interpreting and applying our laws through the 70 to 80 cases it decides to hear each year, mainly because it's seen as an umpire, not as a player. While I view the judicial branch as the crown jewel of our constitutional republic, it has over the years gotten out of its lane on more than one occasion by acting like another political branch. Over the years, the Supreme Court has developed various legal doctrines like substantive due process to create new rights out of whole cloth, rights that are neither in the text nor would the framers ever envision that these rights existed or would be created by 9 unelected judges at the time of the founding. By vesting federal power in Article I, federal legislative power in Article I, and then reserving to the states to determine their own affairs, our founders believed that policy decisions must reside ultimately in the people. As senators, we work on our constituents' behalf here in Washington, and every 6 years, they let us know whether we're doing a good job or not. When the Supreme Court blatantly engages in policymaking, it takes away the power of the people to decide for themselves and to hold their government accountable. Agree or disagree with the results of a given Supreme Court decision? Over our nation's history, there's been something for everyone to love or hate, from Plessy versus Ferguson, which established the shameful separate but equal doctrine for public schools, ultimately overruled in Brown versus Board of Education, to Obergefell, which mandated same-sex marriages. When the Supreme Court creates a right that is not even mentioned in the Constitution, the independence and the legitimacy of the Supreme Court itself is called into question because consent is discarded. Legitimacy of our government institutions is something we have always debated in America, and we've even fought a war over it. The Declaration of Independence itself affirms that government derives its just powers from the consent of the governed. That very principle is undermined when judges rewrite the Constitution to their liking. Where is the legitimizing consent? President Lincoln stated it another way. He said, "No man is good enough to govern another man without that man's consent." How are these so-called unenumerated rights, you might call them naked to the invisible to the naked eye, how are those rights any different? That is what can happen when unelected judges invalidate state laws and impose a one-size-fits-all policy regime on our entire country. Again, like or dislike the results in an individual case, but we should all be concerned about the legitimacy of our governing institutions when they so readily discard consent of the governed. I view the confirmation proceedings as a way to get back and reflect on first principles, on the role of our judiciary in our constitutional system. President Biden has made no bones about his intention to nominate a Supreme Court justice who has an expansive view of unenumerated, invisible rights. Judge Jackson? Well, she wouldn't answer our questions on this topic. I didn't ask her to prejudge a case or commit to a particular outcome in a disputed area of law, but I did ask her about her judicial philosophy. She says she doesn't have one and hasn't thought much about it. That's simply not a credible response, and I believe demonstrates a lack of candor. Maybe she was overcoached. But I left the confirmation hearings concerned about her approach to unwritten rights. Judge Jackson has a marvelous legal education. She's a charming person. She has a vast practical experience, something I think is a real plus, having served as a public defender, a federal district judge, and a circuit court judge, and not just an academician. Someone of her impressive caliber surely has a judicial philosophy, but maybe she just didn't want to talk about it. Time after time, when we ask about her judicial philosophy, she pivoted to something she called methodology. But let me be clear, methodology is not a judicial philosophy. I'm glad when she tells us that she proceeds from a place of neutrality, but that tells us nothing as to whether she believes that the Constitution has a fixed meaning. The order in which she decides to read the party's briefs tells us nothing as to whether and to what extent a judge, now quoting Justice Breyer, her mentor, will look to consequences including contemporary conditions, social, industrial, and political, of the community affected when deciding cases. Now, the main types of contrasting judicial philosophies include judicial activism versus judicial restraint, loose construction versus strict construction, and a living document approach versus original intent. Justice Barrett, for example, called herself an originalist and a textualist, an approach championed by her mentor, Justice Scalia. That would place her in the judicial restraint and strict constructionist camp. In other words, she might be skeptical of invisible or unenumerated rights. For us to fulfill our constitutional duties, we need answers to our questions about how a judge views judge-made law. My concerns were further elevated as I reviewed Judge Jackson's record and I saw examples of activism bleeding over in her decisions. One of the opinions from her time on the D.C. court demonstrates the serious concerns I have about her ability to follow the clear letter of the law as opposed to her personal preferences. Others have mentioned, and I will as well, the case of Make the Road New York versus McAleenan, where the American Civil Liberties Union and others challenged a regulation requiring expedited removal for people who illegally enter our country. The Immigration Nationality Act gives the Department of Homeland Security, and I quote, sole and unreviewable discretion to apply expedited removal proceedings. That does not leave any gray area for interpretation. Sole and unreviewable discretion is about as clear as it comes. But Judge Jackson, who presided over this case, decidedly did not stay in her lane, as she says she attempts to do. She went beyond this unambiguous text to deliver a political win to a progressive group and in the process entered an injunction barring the use of this important tool that's needed by our Border Patrol and immigration authorities to deter people from violating our immigration laws. Unsurprisingly, as we've heard, her decision was overruled by the D.C. Circuit Court. I believe this is a clear-cut example, about as clear as you can possibly get, of Judge Jackson ignoring the written law in order to achieve a result that she preferred. There have only been 115 Supreme Court justices in our nation's history. That's why it's crucial that we use these proceedings to understand if a judge will truly stay in their lane, or whether they will attempt to legislate from the bench and deliver what Justice Biden and his Democratic colleagues are unable to achieve through the legislative process. A judge must call balls and strikes, and given what I've seen and her unwillingness to disclose her judicial philosophy and a disavow an expansionist view of unenumerated rights, I have concerns that Judge Jackson will be pinch hitting for one team or the other. I will vote no.